Thanks very much for inviting me to talk, and thanks to PRONI for making the facilities available. And I'm glad to see so many people who are prepared to miss their lunch just to listen to the rubbish that I have to say. So I have a lot to get through, so I'm going to kick on and move very quickly. If we can hold questions till the end, I'll be happy to take them. My bus back to Dublin's not till 5:30, so I can take a fair few questions at the end. Okay, the photograph or the image you see here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about the general broad history of granite and stone movement and shipment around the Irish Sea Basin, as I call it, and then we will focus back in due course on Newcastle and the two very earliest granite trackways or railways that were built into the hills to get the granite out. And I will finish at around the 1830s. But of course, the granite industry was really only getting going then. But it's the very early period that I'm most interested in. If anyone wanted to ask me back some other time to talk about the later history, I'll be happy to do so. But we'll focus on the very early days tonight and today and the context. This is just to, if you're sitting in Mournes, you would be somewhere here, just to the right. And you would be looking down, but this is the view in 1770, similar to what you'll see today from Mournes, and you will see there is no harbour. Okay, there's no harbour as such, but there was a fishing industry. There were these little, what were called in Irish, and the word translated, it was carried through in Northern Ireland, a pert, or port, and the plural was pertina in Irish. And there were these little, just little slipways and little nooks that they pulled the boats up into, a bit like you see in the west of Ireland even to this day. And the port, the harbour itself, didn't come until much later. So this is our title. The key people in Newcastle, in terms of getting the industry going, were John Lynn. And John Lynn is well known, I think, in Newcastle lore, where I'm sort of speaking as a Newcastle resident myself, or part-time resident in Newcastle. Everyone knows about John Lynn. Everyone knows that he built the trackway first. It's supposedly the first trackway up the mountain. And I think it's Newry and Mourne District Council has spent a lot of money restoring it and opening it as a walkway. But I don't know if it's good news or bad news for them, but I've discovered an earlier one, which is really what you should be taking notes on today. And this was built by Thomas Rogers around 1807 and 1808, and it's still walkable, it's still accessible, and I think it's even nicer than the one that the council has restored. So let's see, I might get run out for saying this. I might not get back safely across the border tonight. We'll see. And then, as I say, we'll contextualise it in the context of what went on around the Irish Sea Basin between Ireland and England. So the places we're talking about, if you know Newcastle, you'd be sitting up there, presumably to the north of where it says Newcastle, and you'd be looking down towards the mountain, and you would see the big gaping hole in the quarry in the mountain. And the first of those, what's to the left as you look south from Mournes, is the earlier quarry, the one that John Lynn opened in 1824, and there was a later one. This is bigger and this is more visible. Thankfully, they've been planting trees in them in the last 10 years or so, so they're less, day by day, they're less visible. But this was Lynn's trackway, granite trail down the railroad, down the hillside to the pier he built in 1824. The one I am more interested in is from the pier, and it comes south, and it comes down this route and goes to another quarry on Millstone Mountain. I have some people here from Newcastle. I'm going to say it, and I never get it right. Is it Drinivir? Drinivir?
Drinivar.
I never can get that right. After 20 years in Newcastle, I can't get that right. Drinivar. Okay. So anyway, granite quarrying is nothing new in Newcastle. If you go up the mountain, you will find any number of millstones like this one. You can see it's been cut out. It's been, you see the chisel marks, and this is very ancient. This millstone quarrying was the very earliest type of granite quarrying that took place in Newcastle. There are hundreds, well, dozens of these abandoned millstones, part finished, around the mountain. There's another one you can see there, maybe a little bit hard to spot. These are all big size mill stumps. They're Victorian. They're maybe 1.5 meter diameter. These are the very earliest type of mill stones, and they always came in pairs. And this is from a coastal quarry. Actually, it's between the tide, the high water and the low water mark, and it's down at Harry Lock down in Waterford Harbour. But it gives you an idea of how millstones always were cut and shipped in pairs, the top stone and the bottom stone, and they had to mate and match. And people wonder how you got them off the mountain, and of course that shows you how easy it was, because each of them, they pierced it with here for the drive mechanism to fit into. And these were, of course, they came fairly rough. They were shipped fairly rough, and then they were fine-tuned on site when they arrived at the mill. So all you do is you stand them up and you put a dirty great big pole between them, and you have kind of an axle and two wheels, and you can pretty well roll it anywhere you want. Your biggest problem is probably controlling the speed at which it runs down the hill. And what they did here was, and the same would have happened at Newcastle before the pier, they simply floated the boat in. It's high water, boat settled. They tied it underneath, boat lifted off, away you go. Anywhere around the Irish Sea, no problem, you can ship them anywhere. So you find millstones with Newcastle granite, Slievedonnor granite, way up anywhere around the Irish Sea. But the earliest one that we can identify is at Nendrum Monastery. Daft Eddies? You don't know Daft Eddies, I'm sure. But it's near Daft Eddies, up on Strangford Lock, and it's a tide mill going back to 800-900 AD, and the granite is from the Mourne area. In fact, it's not just from Mourne we can identify, it's from the Bloody Bridge Valley. So this gives us some idea of the kind of the broad shipments of granite that were going on in the early to mid 1800s. And granite shipment was a big industry. The granite producing regions are all marked in the bright red. That's the Mournes, County Wicklow. Galway really wasn't producing for international markets or even Irish markets at all. Huge market, huge production in Cornwall. And the other big producing area was up at Aberdeen, which is just off the map. But the infrastructure that was involved in supporting these industries was quite extensive. We all know, we probably have heard of the schooners which sailed out of Newcastle and out of Annalong and across the Irish Sea. They were trading back and forth with grain and potatoes and coal and wool and all of those sort of agricultural and prime commodities. But in many cases, they were shipping coming out of a place like Whitehaven over towards Cumbria with coal, and they were going with backloads of granite. So in many cases, granite shipment was very cheap because it was a backload, and the primary cargo was coming from England to here. And the backload was essentially shipped more or less free of charge, because if you didn't load with granite, you had to load with ballast. So in substitute for ballast, you could load with granite, particularly cobblestones. So shipping cobblestones was, from Mourne, was a very, very effective way of getting the product to the market. Essentially, it was an alternative to ballast, and it was more or less cost nothing to ship. So the biggest producing area would have probably been Aberdeen in the mid-1800s. And Aberdeen granite was shipping between 25 and 50,000 tons a year into the English market and being shipped as far as London. Down Devon and Cornwall here in particular, from Dartmoor, from Loo, LWOE Harbour, huge shipments of construction granite, building stone into London. But apart from that, there was also a huge market for engineering granite, for lighthouses, piers, breakwaters. And that was shipped all over the United Kingdom in those days, including Ireland. Dublin, we just look at the very much, in the case of Newcastle, the market was very much a local market. It was from Newcastle into Downpatrick. So an amazing amount of stuff was shipped from Newcastle to Downpatrick. And an awful lot of the public buildings, the jail, the courthouse, a whole string of other buildings in Dunpatrick were built from Newcastle granite. And of course, people think, Dunpatrick is not on the sea, but yes, it is. If you go out up the Irish Sea and you go into Strangford, and before the drainage system was built there on the Coyle Estuary, you could go right down to the back of Dunpatrick, and you could sail down right to a point behind the jail, and you could get the product into Dunpatrick very easily. Portaferry, some work was done in Portaferry using Newcastle granite, and then it was shipped into Belfast at a later time. I'll move on and just show you, in every case there was a huge infrastructure to connect the granite quarries to the shipping industry. And this is generally the situation you see down in Cornwall. Irish Sea, the channel I think we might call it, the granite producing area is in the middle, and you had this connection. And the connection, if we look at it in more detail, there's the granite producing area, and particularly up at around this place called Cheese Ring, there were a string of granite quarries. And they had built initially a canal from this point all the way down to Loo to get the product right down to the harbour side and ship it. Later, they built a railway to replace the canal, and the railway then got continued right up to the quarries. And these are the various individual producing areas shown with the yellow dots. And within some of the quarries, they had their own network of railways. You can see these are all the rail lines in the mid-1800s. So huge amount of railway infrastructure supporting all this. Dublin didn't rely on railway infrastructure. Dublin had a very much a different situation. This is where we hung out, if I could use that term, around Blessington, and starting from 1700, I have receipts from ancestors of mine who supplied granite to Trinity College for construction work there, and it was we had a string of quarries, each lasting about from anywhere from 40 to 150 years. I went through a series of quarries, all in the Blessington area. And the last of them was opened in 1824 and survived until 1966. And that was at Ballynockham, which I think is fairly well known. But there were a string of those before that. And that was shipped by road, followed this old route. And what was shipped from Wicklow were called wallers. I'll show you in a moment what a waller is. But in Dublin, we were spoiled for choice, because if you dig a hole anywhere, okay, this is the granite-producing region in the mountains, but anywhere else, dig a hole, you will very quickly find limestone, various qualities, but you will get limestone without any problem. And very, very hard granite occurs at the coast. And the engineering granite for harbours, breakwaters, lighthouses, and so on, slipways in Dublin, was all supplied from Dalkey and Killiney quarries, which are right beside the harbour, easy to ship into the city. And then the very fine stones we brought actually from Portland Bill down in Dorset. And we've always been good in Ireland at finding Irish solutions to Irish problems, but this was the Dublin solution to the Dublin problem. If you look at Trinity College, you've two types of stone. 20 years ago it was all so black you couldn't tell them apart, but it's all being cleaned, and you can now see these are the granite, these are the wallers. You might call them the equivalent of the concrete block. Okay, they weighed about five of those, weighed a ton approximately. And this was what was used, granite. This is the way we solved the problem in Dublin. We brought those on by horse and cart down from people like myself, producing them, supplying them, controlling the quarrying, controlling the shipping, and controlling the construction sites. So it was very much an integrated business. People think of just these guys out in the mountains hacking granite out. But there's no value in the granite. You know, granite's only a lump of stone. The value is in converting it into a finished building. So my ancestors would have been involved as engineers and architects, construction people. And you got the value and you got the profit by bringing it right through the entire process to a finished building. But the roads were bad. And the very first building that was built, what we did in Dublin was we brought in these. This is the Portland stone. And you can see the Portland stone is used in the columns. It's used in the capitals, and it's used in things like the porticos and pediments and these architectural, more fine architectural carved pieces. And this was brought in from Dorset, Portland in Dorset. And if you look at the size, if you take that one there, okay, you can calculate as much as you like and as often as you like, but you will find that the biggest of those sections weighs 5 tons. Okay, so here we're dealing with wallers weighing about 5 per ton, and here you're dealing with column sections weighing about 5 tons each. So they're one of these equals 25 of these guys in weight terms. We could not ship those from the mountains until the 1830s, and the very first shipment was 1831. And there was a great ceremony, and it was a fantastic time when they first shipped column sections out of Ballynockan to Dublin, and it's still remembered in local folklore. So you can see the Dublin solution better there, that's part of Trinity. You can see, look at this, just this set piece here has been cut out in Portland stone, and the rest is in granite. Oh, sorry, go back one there. If we look across the road at Bank of Ireland, sorry about the tree, but you can see the same. You can see your wallers, and you can see your column blocks and your Portland stone. And it's so nice and clean now that you hardly notice the difference. They both mellow over the years, and they blend in together. We'll move on towards the Mournes and the Newcastle area in particular. The Mournes granite is defined really but within the sections area from Newcastle to Hilltown to Ross Trevor, and the long Irish Sea is here, and Carlingford is here. Unfortunately, the granite is not quite down to the coast. Now, if it had been, that would have been bliss, but it's not. So, in the original pier was built around 1807, 1808, and we'll come to that. And it was Thomas Rogers who built that. But the new pier was built 1828 odd. And in 1824, John Lynn took a lease on this quarry from the Earl of Annesley, who basically owned all the land around Newcastle and the mountains behind. And Lynn opened this quarry and built his trackway straight down almost to the pier. Not quite to the pier, and shift it out. Now, he was relying on the earlier work of Thomas Rogers, who built the first pier. This is the 1837, the first ordnance map. And what's interesting about this is that it only shows this trackway, or this railway coming down the mountain. It doesn't show anything to the south, but my research has indicated that there was another one following this sort of route and heading south, which we'll come to. What Lynn did was taking the Newcastle granites in this area here, down his trackway, down to the pier, and he supplied projects in Newcastle itself. Quite a few buildings in Newcastle are built of his local granite. And he was a building contractor who over the years became more involved in civil engineering works. And there is a paper which, if you're on the mailing list, we will send to you on Monday. We decided it was better and environmentally better to email it to you rather than to print the 16 pages that it consists of. So there's no need to take extensive notes. We will be giving you this 16-page document by email on Monday. And it will give tables of John Lynn's, his work, and his detail and sources of information on him and everything I'm saying today. But Lynn, anyway, he shipped mostly up the coast, and as I said, round the back through Strangford Lock, Strangford Narrows into Downpatrick, and Portaferry, the slipway at Portaferry is his. But the problem that we have is that he only supplied his own building contracts and his own building work. He wasn't using the granite to supply the granite market. In fact, he had an incentive not to give the granite from Newcastle to other people who might be competitors of his. So it was very much a closed John Lynn industry for John Lynn's market. And it was a huge discouragement and disincentive he had every incentive not to give his product, his make his granite available to anyone else. So in that sense, what happened in Newcastle was very isolated, very local, and it wasn't serving the granite market as such. It was serving John Lynn's individual building project. But this is a view down the trackway, and Pamela McClelland is here today, who kindly gave me this photograph, and it's from her own family collection, and it's fantastic to have, and it shows the trackway, it shows his route down the hill, and you can see the cable. It's a funicular type system, so you have two granite carts, one at the top, one at the bottom. It's very simple. You fill the one at the top with stone, and its weight goes down, and it pulls the empty one up. So all you had to have is a rope between them, and a wheel, as it were, or a braking system at the top. Run the rope up, feed it round the wheel, and you have load your granite, pull the lever, and down she goes. No power needed. Gravity was the power, but you had no mechanical or electrical power required to feed it. And that survived. It had a lot of ups and downs because the pier was quite often demolished in Newcastle. It was wrecked a few times. And the line itself, well, I don't know if you use that word that we use in Dublin or in the countryside, but bockety. It's certainly bockety, if you know what that word means. I mean, you just look at the way it's laid. And the gauge doesn't seem to me to be totally consistent. And it's humpy and hollowy, you know. It's not. It wasn't well constructed. And this is in the 1930s, towards the end of its life. But we have other family photographs from people's family albums in Newcastle, and this shows around the same time. One of the granite workers at the top of the line, and you can see he's clipping on the chains. It's unfortunate the crane cable comes down here, and it gets confused with the telegraph pole behind it, unfortunately. But this is what he's doing. He's clipping it on, and this is his cap. So I think this is actually what's known as a slipe, and they were just using it to drag this lump of granite across to the top point on the tram trackway and load it for running down the line. And this is one of what were called bogies or wagons. You can see again the cables lying on the ground, and you can see this is the cable holding it. So that cable would have gone up around the wheel system and down to the empty bogie at the bottom. And the weight of the granite here would have propelled it down the line. As I said, your big problem was controlling the speed of the descent, not actually powering it. And these guys are happily sitting out, probably Sunday afternoon, you know, down to Mournes, lick a bit of ice cream, have a cup of coffee, you know, think about going up the mountain. Well, these guys beat you to it, they've done it. And this is one of the old, this is still there. It's not my photograph, but it's still there. A little bit blurred, but this is one of the abandoned bogies, not off this trackway, but off another trackway just to the south of it, in a Carr's Face quarry, about 2 miles south of Newcastle. I'm guessing that they were, as near as damn it, identical to the ones that were used. We don't have a bogie from Newcastle. There's something that claims to be a bogie exhibited by the council, but I'm a bit sceptical about that. I think it's a... I see Pamela smiling at that one as well. I don't think we believe that it's... This is the genuine article. This is abandoned up near Carr's Face quarry. It's still there. I don't think we will run it just at the moment, but if you wanted to see... an actual funicular railway in operation. There's a link here, and this will be in the document we send to you. I'm going to move on quickly and show you this map, which I don't think has ever been seen up north before. But this is from 1838 to 1839, and it shows you the situation at Newcastle and the pier, the original pier of 1807, 1808, built by Thomas Rogers. Then it shows you the pier that was built in 1824, and then the storm of the big wind age, 1st of January 1839, demolished the pier. And you can see here the end of the pier is portrayed just as a shambles. It's all in bits, and there are various sketches as to whether they might, ideas, we might extend it out this way, we might go this way, we might hook it around. We might build another pier road this way, we might build one this way. They hadn't made their mind up. And this was why the industry never really developed well in Newcastle, because after the piers were wrecked in 1839, it took until 1851 before they were fully restored and operational again. So there was nothing really moving in the granite industry in between. But down in Cornwall and Devon, people like John Freeman were developing huge, shipping industries, transport networks. So they filled the gap that Newcastle should have filled. And it really had a proper could have had a proper place in the international Anglo-Irish granite industry, but it never developed that because of the poor harbour situation at Newcastle. What this does show is, it's small, but it is written there, and it shows John Lynn's railway of 1824, the one I showed you in the photographs. It says railway from the granite quarry. So I don't think that one's been seen north of the border, but John Lynn's railway then, this is an 1850s map. His quarry is here, and his original quarry is here, and they've opened another quarry over here. This section of the track is just horizontal. It's on the flat. You more or less pull the bogies or drag them across to this point, and then you sent them down this 30-degree incline down to the harbour. What you find then by 1903, this ordnance survey map, there were actually two trackways, one from Lynn's quarry and a separate one up to the other. And this goes back to what I said, it was a bockety line, it was never properly built. It wasn't built with sufficient engineering endeavour to make it workable, and probably because there was no point in investing huge money in it because the pier was so unreliable and so often out of action because of storm damage. Anyway, what the council display in Newcastle, it shows you the granite trail, it marks the route, but what it doesn't point out is that it only brought the granite as far as this point, and that's where the trail starts at the moment. But if you look on the aerial photographs, you will see that the rest of the trail, there is a zigzag here, which is never talked about. There's a pedestrian walk here, takes the shortcut, but the zigzag went again on tracks to there, zigged, and went down to the stone yard, which was actually towards the village. And then it was brought back, if they were cutting it and carving it, then it was brought back in finished condition to the harbour area. So that, I think, has been neglected by the council as part of the overall situation. And this is one of the old photographs from the Lawrence collection, and you will see a schooner at Newcastle. And here you can see the stone yard and the cranes in the stone yard. And this was a Robinson stone yard, where there's an apartment block today. But it's never pointed out that that was an integral part of the Newcastle system. So what we've looked at now, we have John Lynn's quarry, we have the later quarry, we had a couple of lines here over the time and the zigzag, but this is the earlier one that I wanted to really to bring to your attention today. And this route is, this is Google Earth, and it goes up to that quarry named Drinivar.
Drinivar.
I'll get it eventually. Drinivar. If I bang myself on the head often enough, I'll get that right. Drinivar. It goes up to Drinivar Quarry. And you can actually see it there. I've just put red dots over it, but the trail is there, and it's very much walkable. The problem, why people haven't quite discovered it, is because when it comes down here, it gets a bit messy. And you're coming out of the harbour, you come across by the Coast Guard cottages, and then right on front of the Widow's Row, the Widow's Row, which people from Newcastle will know of. But here, at this point, there's a block of houses, the terrace of houses beyond the Widow's Row. The last two houses actually were built across the line. And at that point, people kind of don't realise what's going on. So you have to actually ignore the fact that the line disappears under those two houses and then follow up this route. And at this point here, there's been a landslide and it's blocked here. So what you've got to do to walk it, you've got to go from Newcastle, you can follow this section, but then you've got to go back down and you've got to go up the granite trail and follow this walk through the forest, and you pick it up again at this point and you can complete the walk up here. But it's just a landslide. As an engineer, it's no problem to shift it. I just want to outline this because everybody in Newcastle knows of John Lynn, but nobody knows of Thomas Rogers and his efforts. And Thomas Rogers built this road that I'm talking about, this southern one. He built the pier, and to build the pier, he built the railroad to get the granite down off the mountain to build the pier in 1807, 1808. But I think what we have to do is we have to look a little bit at the background. It was built under the direction of William Ansley. He was 3rd Earl Ansley, and he was a director of the revenue, and he was very much involved. The revenue service established the Coast Guard. The Coast Guard in those days wasn't for life-saving. It was a part of the division of the revenue to protect the coast from smuggling. It had nothing to do with life-saving. It was all about prevention of smuggling. And he, Ansley was a dodgy character. I mean, there's always a story about these guys, and it's long and complicated. But briefly, what he did was he married the daughter of the St. Lawrence family in 1803. And St. Lawrence's was the Earl of Howth, and Howth, County Dublin, you will know it. You've probably flown into Dublin Airport, and as you see Howth as it appears on the left of the aircraft and the approaches into Dublin, the aircraft is actually flying this route across here, just north, parallel to the coast. You will see the piers. If you don't know Howth, you'll see it next time you're flying into Dublin. You'll see the pier. The marina is now in here. But what they were doing in 1800 to 1810, they were building that harbour as a mail packet station, and they built a road from there all the way into the city. But to build the pier, they built this trackway out to the Howth Quarries. And there was a huge big scandal. Of course, there was always scandals about these things, because the figures showing the volume of material excavated from the quarry and that the Earl of Howth was being paid for, it was about three times more than was actually the volume that could have been used in the harbour. So what's new, you know, we're used to, reminds me of something else that's ongoing at the moment we won't talk about. But anyway, so you know what I'm talking about. Anyway, then the quarries at the nose of Howth, there's some mystery as to where it all went, but it didn't go into the pier. But it went into his pocket, the money for it went into his pocket. But the state then took over and said, forget this nonsense, this pier will take 50 years to build and it's costing a fortune. So the precursor of the Office of Public Works took it over and they built it. But the trackway is still there, and it was there at the time that he was courting the Earl of Howth's daughter, and they were building it, and they were making a pile of money in all sorts of ways out of it. So I think that's where he got the idea that he would do the same at Newcastle. And of course the same corruption also went on at Newcastle. And he was actually dismissed in 1810. But the guy who built the first pier at Newcastle, Thomas Rogers, the lighthouse service had basically decided he was a great guy. And he had built 5 or 6 lighthouses around the Irish coast. He also was responsible for maintenance of all of the Irish lighthouses, which seems incredible that all of this would be given to one person. But anyway, they discovered that the lighthouses were in appalling condition. Half the lights weren't working, some of them weren't manned, a couple of them collapsed into the sea, and there was a big scandal, and he was fired, and Ansley was fired as well from his job. And so when they were building the pier at Newcastle, all this was going on. So in 1807, 1808, you wonder, how did he build that pier in Newcastle so quickly? Well, of course, he didn't. He was fired. He had put in the foundations for the entire pier, but he had only built 1/3 of it. And at that stage, a final account was drawn up and he was dismissed. And this is the final account. It's actually described as a pier in Dundrum Bay. But believe me, we have the maps, and it's slightly misleading. They described it as a pier in Dundrum Bay. And I always think, was that because Ansley didn't want to describe it as Newcastle Pier? Because Newcastle was his. So was this part of the subterfuge that was going on to disguise the fact that he had undertaken to build this pier with the state's money, but it was, as much as anything, it was for his benefit. And of course, everybody was looking after themselves in this, because Thomas Rogers was building the pier when the account was terminated, when the project was terminated and the final account was drawn up. Look what happened. The work he had done was valued at 3,500. And the estimate for the cost of the pier was 8,500, so it wasn't completed by any means. But of the 3,500, the state saw fit to deduct £1,300 for works which were of benefit to him. So in effect, he was building, I think what he was doing, he was building this trackway down to build the pier, and he was going to use the granite for lighthouses and all of the building works that he was doing on the Irish lighthouse system. Now, if that had happened, it would have been a fantastic bonus for Newcastle. But unfortunately, the scam was stopped, and he was fired, and this amount was deducted, and he was given possession of the road for the runway up the hill and the metal road build. Now, when they say metal road, we mean a surfaced road. And this is, in fact, this is actually telling us, in engineering terms, that he had built that trackway. So I searched and searched and searched, and I found these maps dated 1824. Of all places, they were in the archives of the Irish Fisheries Commission, okay, which existed in those days, and that they're in Dublin. They're not in Belfast, they're in Dublin. And this shows 1824, the maps are clearly dated, and this shows the railroad to the granite quarries. So this is the railroad that we're talking about that went across on front of the, goes across on front of the Coast Guard cottage, Coast Guard houses now. It's shown here on another map of the same date, railroad to granite quarries, and this is Lynn's, Rogers's railroad. And here's the proof. It's signed by the various... this plan was approved of by the parties locally interested in its direction, Lord Ansley's letter of 27th of April 1828, and it's signed and dated the 8th of May 1828. This is the agreement that they will extend and continue the work on the pier. And what this is in fact proving is that this is the route that we showed that Rogers constructed, and this is the route he built, I believe, all the way up. And you can see it there, going right up to the quarries under Navier. It's quite separate from the one that the council restored and spent a lot of money on here. And this is perfectly walkable, apart from a small landslide around here. That unworkable section there. I'll show you one or two examples from it. Okay, there's a couple of pieces. That's where it heads off up in front of the Coast Guard's houses. And I think this, to me, I can't be sure, but I'm guessing that this was some sort of an anchor point for when they brought stuff down from the quarry and they weren't quite ready to receive it at the harbour, that they could tie it off against this before the last road crossing going into the harbour. So this is just down in front of your house. Farther up, it passes the widow's cottages, and then this looks like this actually looks like a concrete blockwork. But when you look at it carefully, you realise that it actually is. It's a granite retaining wall, so the root went up there, and this was part of the retaining wall which supported it. And that granite came from that quarry, Drinever, whatever. Farther up the line, if you look, you'll see how it worked. This is where the tracks were laid, one track, second track, see some bolt holes, more bolt holes along as you go, loads of bolt holes. And this was a pedestrian walkway at one side, so when the bogies were going up and down, people could walk at one side in safety. And I think it may have been designed originally as a funicular railway, but I don't believe it worked as a funicular. I think they just used horses to drag the empty bogies up, and they just used gravity to let them come down. There's a lot of reasons why it wouldn't have worked as a funicular, but I do think that they designed it as such. See more photographs of bolt holes. I have any number of examples of these. In lots of time, get a good day, explore it yourself. This is another piece of retaining wall. It was completely overgrown. You have to climb down here and pull back this overgrowth and the burden of growth. You will actually discover that there are loads of these sections where the original slope was like that, and they just leveled it out, put a retaining wall in here, and then this is where the trackway ran. But the proof that it might have originally been a funicular is here. And this section here, a friend of mine, one of the Wicklow boys, mates of mine, this is the track, but this is the passing place. Now, it doesn't come out very well, but the retaining wall comes out this way, and it leaves space. This is exactly halfway up the line, and this is exactly where the two wagons, bogies, would meet. Halfway up the line, when you do your measurements on it, and the line widens out here. And this is where the two wagons would have met, one track, but at a point they had to meet each other and pass, so the line doubled. So I think it may have been designed as a funicular, but I don't think it ever worked as a funicular because of the curves on the line. And this is where it's headed for. This is the quarry, Drenever, whatever you call it at the top. I still can't get that right. That's the quarry at the top. Now, I mean, I guarantee you that is granite. And the Ordnance Survey reports and memorandum in 1885 describes why this granite is like this. I've shown this to geologists and they've said, that's limestone. No, it's granite. Okay? It's laminar granite. It's the only deposit of laminar granite in these islands. And it's particularly attractive because if you think about it, look, you've got all these lovely layers. All you have to do, you know, so much work is done for you because it's layered. It's in 6-inch, 9-inch slabs. So it was ideal for building things like lighthouses and piers. And the amount of labor to shape it into the correct dimension. So you could take as much as you wanted off a particular plane, and it was already flat for you. Half the work was done. So that's what Rogers was building his railway for, to get up, get this stuff, get it down to Newcastle Pier, and use it in his civil engineering works. Okay, just in case, the one thing that was very big out of Newcastle was what they called sets, or shoddies was the term they used locally. And these were the little cobblestones. And huge amounts of that was shipped from Newcastle and later from Annalong when the pier in Newcastle was destroyed. And it went to England, and particularly in the late 1800s when they were building the trams. So things come round again. So where are we now? This is Dawson Street in Dublin, and we're building the new Lewis line. And here we go, look, here we go. This is exactly the sets used to cobble the line. Now, this is 6 months ago, so they're well on with this. But it'll be interesting to see. It's exactly what was taken out of Newcastle, thousands of tons of this, into the hold of ships, as ballast almost, as a backload, taking it free, and it's Liverpool, Manchester, all of the tram systems in England used these. And this is a guy called Thomas Polland, making sets just above Annalong, at Head Road in Annalong. Some of you may know where that is. And I think the Polland family is still there. Pretty sure they're still there. We might even have one of them with us, do we? No? No. And this is how it's shipped nowadays, in a kind of a crude skip. That's it. Thank you very much.